welcome everybody to Powaful Impak. We have two special guest hosts today. We have Porsha from Apartment 5B and Goddess. They're going to be joining me today as we interview one of the best artists that has come out, and his music is so prolific. Let's welcome Amir. How is everybody today, Porsha?
I'm good. All is well. I'm glad to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me.
And Miss Goddess.
Same here, man. I'm really glad to be here. I'm doing good today.
And the man of the hour. Nah. How are you today?
You. One day at a time. I'm okay. Absolutely. Happy to be here. Thank y'all for, you know, everybody pulling up, man. Let's only have a good conversation. Have some fun.
Oh, cool. So, the first thing, I kind of wanted to just get some preliminaries out of the way, only because for those who don't know you and aren't familiar with you, where are you from, and how did growing up wherever you grew up affected how you do your music today?
Well, you know, I'm from the same block. I'm from Mount Vernon. I grew up in New Rochelle. Well, Mount Vernon, New Rochelle, and I spent some time in VA. But mm-hmm. majority of my life has been in New York. And I think, you know, come from a West Indian background, Southern background as far as family. Some family from New York moved to the South, but primarily influence was Jamaican culture, West Indian culture. I don't think it necessarily affected the music. I think it influenced it, you know. The influence on it would be just the musical palette and being able to appreciate music that may be not non-secular, not as popular sounding music. You can appreciate the instrumentation and what it means to, a smaller demographic as opposed to when it goes to a larger demographic. So I would say that's how it affected me. It just widened my scope and taste for different types of music outside of hip hop.
So when you talk about the different types of music outside of hip hop, specifically, which music are you talking about?
I'm talking about primarily everything, whether it's reggae, mm-hmm. it could be some pop sounding music, it could be house, it could be techno, it could be acid music, it could be lo-fi music, it could be, you know, just different ranges of music. Level of specificity and the type of music, just a love for different sounds that, you know, have shaped the world mm-hmm. on a global scale, not just from, corner to corner type of vibe. Yeah.
Yeah, I think what I have noticed that because I noticed when we were growing up, we kind of had a variety of things that we listened to because, you know, we kind of listened to what our parents listened to. And now a lot of the parents are listening to hip hop and not so much as the other stuff. Do you think that affects the way music is being made now?
I don't think it's affecting how it's being made. I think it affects... I don't think it affects it personally. Nah. I mean, and that's subjective, right? I don't personally think it affects it. I think it may play a part in what you choose to use as a point of reference, right? The music has definitely evolved. The technology has evolved around that we use to create the music. So if we were using some of those sounds that they had back then were a lot warmer because they were using reel-to-reels and tapes. That, like, I mean, we talk about the science of sound, right? Versus, you know, everybody's uh-huh. pretty much at home now recording on applications. But when you're using tape and, you know, the stories I've heard about how warmer the vocal sound and richer, you know, of a sound you may get because you're using that, I think that plays a part in it. You may have artists that try to thrive to reach that sound, but It's hard to get it on a computer a lot. And I learned that from like Eddie F. When I was over there with him, he just taught me a lot. Jamie Stover, like a lot of the just engineers I met throughout time.
I mean, yeah, I mean, I listen to 21 Grams often. It's like part of my daily, I don't want to say daily, maybe like three times a week it's on spin, and I listen to it like at work all the time, and I love it because there's no like profanity, there's no curse words in it, so I can listen to it at the office, people can come in, my boss can come in, and I don't have to mute anything or pause anything. So I actually, I don't know if this is just ahead of what we're talking about, but my favorite thing about 21 Grams and one of my favorite things about Amir is his lyrics. And not only lyrics, but even captions on posts and just wisdom, gems that he drops all the time. And one of my favorite lyrics that I kind of tweet all the time is research the research and research it again. So I just want to know, I guess, like if we can at this point in the conversation, like, What do you mean by that? I mean, I interpret it away, but I just want to know, like, what is your sort of thought process behind that? And I think before you go on to say you have to know the facts, the sources. Actually, you said, I think you got to know the sources of whatever it is that you're kind of, you know, learning or quoting or whatever. So, yeah, elaborate on that, if you can.
I think. Absolutely. Appreciate it. Now, I think that, you know, the reason when I said research, research it again, is because we live in a era where nobody's checking credentials of the people that say they who are they. You know, I could go on Instagram and put I'm a doctor. You know, right. Nobody's checking those credentials. Right. If I say certain things are factual, but they're non-factual, but these facts, like I've said before, are like possibly shattered facts. Right. Or what I'm saying at this time may not actually be a truth like that. And you have a ton of people that that just don't do that level of research when they're looking at something. So when they're doing that, it further spreads contaminated information. And I guess to remediate the issue of that on just social media and our day-to-day lives, I just encourage people, if somebody's telling you something is a fact, like you should research it and then research it again, because there's always, as you drill down, you learn more about what you know and what you don't know. Because what I have a thing that I live about, what you don't know is more important than what you do know sometimes.
Facts.
And I feel like, you know, we live in an age where everything is 60-second frames, right? We've been conditioned. Mm-hmm. A lot of us have been conditioned to accept it as that. So when I mention the research, and, you know, then, you know, fact checking is a part of what I do. And it helps me govern a lot of my myself and my day-to-day decisions. Am I operating out of facts, or am I operating out of feelings? Or am I operating in a zone where this decision, you know, later on may benefit me. So it kind of helps me further my consequential thinking process. Yeah. So that's why I say that a lot.
Yeah, that's dope. And I have heard in, just to kind of expand on that, I have heard in previous interviews that you've done on IG Live and, you know, I think other, just various places that you've done interviews, you sometimes say things and then you're like, you can look that up. Like, you actually live by that phrase. Yeah. So, and I've heard that not once, not twice. I've heard that a few times. Like, you'll drop something and then you'll be like, you can look that up. And I'm always like, damn, no, you don't need to look it up. It's already done.
No, I encourage that. And also, fact, I got a fact check. I did curse on 21 Grams, but it wasn't like,
I can't even remember a curse word. I think there's enough gems that it kind of like drowns out any curse words if there are any.
But I did it. Maybe a couple times. I don't know. But I think I just try to avoid, you know, the nonsense. So I like to check myself along the way. So I tell people to look it up, because I think that's telling them to research and research it again. I'm telling you something. I did my research. You can research what I told you again. And yes. then we can reconvene and have a conversation about it. Because I think that's the building blocks mm-hmm. of having great conversation. I can use that. Oh, yeah. So, yeah. So that's why I said that.
And I think people don't realize that your sources, the sources you use have sources. Yes. And they have people who donate to them. And sometimes the information is skewed by donations. One of the biggest things I found is with the Heart Association, they have mm-hmm. all of this information, but then you look and it's funded by the pork industry or it's funded by the chicken industry, and that can skew information. So I love that you say that. It's really important to fact check.
Yes. And even it keeps us out of trouble. I mean, you still may get in trouble fact checking, but at least you're closer to the truth than you were if you really know that this sometimes. And then because the internet has a lot of what they call honeypot, sweet sounding information, but it's not actually accurate. So, it's a place for that. Mm-hmm. We live in a very informational, predatory environment. People put, they'll prey on what you know and don't know. And even if they're telling you something that, they hope that you go spread it as well. Mm-hmm. And it's not true. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, Amir, let me ask you a question.
Absolutely.
First, let me just ask you, where did the name Amir come from?
My godmother, Tracy, she was Muslim, of course. and, my mother at the time was studying a lot, around, Islamic school of thoughts. And I think what happened was I ended up getting the name, my godmother name, Tracy. She ended up passing maybe a couple years back from cancer. So, but she named me Amir. So
that's, your real name.
That's Amir. My real, yes. Yeah, huh?
Okay, all right. I got to ask that. Sometimes, people have stage names and then that's cool. And that's how you spell it?
I spell it like that with two X's to, I had two cousins that passed, right? So the two X's represent, mm-hmm. My cousin Milo, my cousin Kwame.
Ah, nice.
After they passed, I changed it to two X's, yeah.
Okay, to pay homage. I respect mm-hmm. that. I respect that a lot. So you earlier you're talking about fact checking and I could tell that you are very well aware that we're living in different times, right?
Absolutely.
Especially with the way society is. I mean, I think collectively we're all transitioning one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you, how do you feel about what's happening right now? Like, what's your thoughts about society and where it is right now? We'll go into the music part, but
that's okay. It's a good question. Ask anything y'all want to ask. I'm with anything. Anything you thought me, I'm ready.
Okay.
I promise you. And that's not even arrogant. I just like conversation because it's not a right or wrong question. It's just we here to learn about each other. So to answer that, I would say,
you think we're moving in the right direction, or what direction do you think it looks like we're moving into?
I'm going to give you my Amir disclaimer, what I normally do. I'm not qualified to say, but this is my perspective, what I think, right? So I will say, that there seems to be a shift in one of the isms, which is whether it's classism. There seems to be a involuntary shift in class, right? And when you create class, you create subdivisions of how people live in based on the boxes they check in society. They may live a certain way versus somebody else not living that way, right? Because now you're finding yourself pivoting, whether it's economic, whether it's education, whether it's spirituality, whatever box they choose to operate or use as a pivot for their decisions. I think, pandemic included, it forced people inside of their house, but it didn't necessarily force you to go inside of yourself. So when you had to stay in the house, you might have physically had to be still. But the people who started to work on themselves and go internally, I think, were the biggest benefactors of the pandemic. Now, it doesn't mean that the people who were in the house didn't benefit either, but there's different levels of commitment to self that took place, right? And when you commit to the self, some of these things outwardly show, not only just in your behavior, but the results you start to, you start to see in your life and see around, and then you start looking at things through a different like telescope now, right? So now, I think that there's a like I said before, I think there's definitely a recalibration happening with society. I've seen a lot of people that were doing things in the dark, right? Working hard or doing certain shit. I'm getting promoted in jobs or things are happening. I've seen people who were doing things that were not so savory or, participate in uncouth actions on a day-to-day basis, right? So now you start to see them get put on front street. So I think people who were not being accountable were kind of forced to be accountable because everybody was starting to look at things a little bit more because they had more time to be still. But these things have been taking place for the last decade or better, right? So I think that there was forced accountability taking place too. So
I see you on that. No, it's true. I feel like a lot of people, even from conversations I've had with different people, they say, I never spent so much time alone and I really learned a lot about myself. There are some people that are really learning a lot about themselves because they had no choice but to spend that time alone.
Yeah.
And I definitely do see that shift. How do you feel the mental health in society is transitioning?
Ooh. I think that it was taboo at first, right? It was a taboo thing. Anything dealing with mental health was kind of a taboo and swept under the rug. Oh, you're okay. He or she, or they're just this way because of this happening. They're still going through grieving or they face the trauma. But, having said traumas or you're grieving or whatever mental health ailments that we may have, I think this also, like I said, you have to hold the mirror up to yourself and also the people you are around. Because certain people I haven't spoken to since the beginning of the pandemic, it doesn't mean that I don't love them. This is relatives included, right?
Right.
So,
how'd that make you feel that there are some that you don't talk to anymore?
Some people you can't talk to because they're not necessarily here anymore. Some people you can talk to and it kind of makes you realize the value in time and how you spend it. Right. Make sure my phone's not about to die. Oh yeah, hold on. We gotta charge this. Yeah, just make sure that we on the same. I'm sorry. Yeah. You can hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, just making sure that we're on the same wavelength, the same time frame, and we can move accordingly. And that's how I would take it. Yeah. But yeah, so I feel like those were the things that were taking place that I saw the most.
Did you feel like you had the boundaries, like with certain people? Is that what you're saying? Like, you just had to set
some. I won't even say the boundaries were set. I just think a lot of those things, we had to. Yeah, I could if you want. Yeah, yeah. It was definitely forced, but some of it needed to happen, right? Some of these relationships, we needed to see the fiber of it to recognize that this is something that's needed or not needed, right? And that goes for just a humanistic point of view. It has nothing to do with music or entertainment. We are human first, right? So the most divisive thing, as long as they can keep us divided, when I say they, I mean the powers that be that benefit from divisiveness, right? So there is a, there's a, once again, if you really want to know who benefited the most mentally or spiritually, that'll be hard for me to gauge, right? A measure. But a lot of people did make a ton of money, and some people equate money to happiness in a pandemic, and some people don't have money anymore, right? So there's a dark and a light side to this, you know, and I think that affects people's mental health, because when they don't have to worry about day-to-day living, it gives you the gift of certain level of time to work on, like I said, oneself again, and like kind of push things and around in your head and your heart to kind of fix if it did damage it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I feel that. You said, like, you know, you're talking about feeling divided. How do you bridge that gap with when we live in a society now where there's it's a divided society? How do we bridge that? What do you think is the way to bridge that?
Well, a couple of years ago, I had talked about this when I was at Fordham. I had did a seminar, and I was speaking there, and I came up with this, personal school of thought. I called it the three H's, right? And I was saying that if the head, the heart, and the home, and that's where we begin to, if these things existed in your home first, right? That's where, you know, parental pass down, you know, these things transcended generation to generation, because this became what we call culture, right? That's the first thing we have to, some things you got to unpack and some things you got to pack, unpack and pack. Yeah. To be, a better version of self, the head and the heart. Right.
Right.
I said on my album, or the tape, is your head is above your heart for a reason, right? So there is a level of, I would say that we, a level of thinking that we have to apply, you know, application. There's an application of thought that must take place in order to make these sound decisions. So the head, the heart, and the home, I call those the pillars of change of how we start these things, step in the right direction.
I like the foundation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I like that. The head, the heart, and the home. The three H's. That makes a lot of sense.
Yes, let's kind of slide back into the music of it all. And I was just kind of wondering, can you talk about True Soul and the way y'all approach music individually and collectively?
A True Soul with Pete, you know, everybody knows that's familiar with this work. When you're dealing with like a Pete Rock or a Dr. Dre premiere, like there's an expectation for quality control. So True Soul, to me, operates from that, like that, you know, thoughtful mood music that Howard Pete has explained it to me, like that's one of the pillars of True Soul. It's to move one soul. It's healing, a healing process. Because music should be used as a tool, right, to heal and to bring joy. So I think with True Soul, that's one of the pillars. And I'm pretty sure these things change over time as, you know, whatever is needed to make one's day better or moment better, your music should adjust or make one feel just better, right? So I say that's our approach, having fun and making sure we stay true to self. In that same point in time, you know, the instrumentation that he uses in his production versus a lot of other people, you know, Pete has a unique way of layering his music, like the layers he used in the sampling. I never seen anyone that can hear three samples and how they would sound together, and like it's orchestrated. It's almost weird to watch, but because I never hear it like that. I hear it like one sample, I'm like, oh, that's fire. And then he'll bring in two other pieces, and you're like, oh, that's crazy. So his approach forces you, forces me, I should say, to approach it with a sense of multi-layered thought as well. Because if he's approaching it with different layers of music, I just can't jump on those, that level of production, those soundscapes with a normal approach, hoping to achieve. If you approach it with a normal approach, you're going to get normal results. So I try to just make sure that I match his energy and his effort more than anything. So we try to match each other's effort and be honest with each other and just have fun in the lab. So that's, I would say those are some of the things that how we approach it. And we don't bite our tongue when we like or dislike something about how we approaching it at the time. It's a very respectful grown man vibe in there. It's very, you know, brotherly. It's a lot of love. And when somebody tells you something out of love, you know, whether they agree with this approach, try it this way, you know that it's not malicious. So when it's not a malicious intent, it just makes it better, man. When somebody can check you and they know, and you know they love you, it's that causes a different level of growth and approach.
Takes a lot of trust to do that. How did you and Pete Rock meet?
Well,
tell us about that.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, so when I met Pete, it was I met Pete through CL, which is crazy, right? So I met Pete through CL at a photo shoot years ago. But I mean, I was living on South 2nd Avenue, and then I had moved over to 71 Hillside. Now everybody knows his family lives at 77 Hillside, but the house that I moved into D.O. was ran with having all these guys and Pete's like a brother to Pete. So I had ended up moving downstairs, well, upstairs, but the basement was downstairs in the house. So I would see Pete. I met him at the photo shoot. I would see him in the hood moving around the barbershop on the block sometimes. I would say, what up? He knew me. What up, man? You know, kept it cool. I never bothered him. He knew I did music. I never, like, you know, ran him down. You know, was annoying. But I know he knew that, you know, I got busy. So we just kind of kept it like that. And over time, you know, he would pass me beats and we just built a relationship over. It wasn't like an overnight thing. He doesn't move. It's not very impulsive like that when it comes to the music. So it took, you know, some time for me to understand his process. But he actually had probably, this would have happened probably 5 years ago, but I didn't understand when he gave me those 12 beats, what he was doing. He was only picked one or two of the beats and didn't touch the rest. That was the most complete sounding beat to me at the time. So what I did, I was like, damn, that was dumb. When I realized he gave me 12 beats again, and this time I was able to attack each one and I gave it back. Then he goes back and does his thing, and that ended up giving birth to, you know, what we have now. And him saying that my voice matched his production, where his production is at now, was a perfect match for where his production is at currently. So that's how, you know, the relationship had always forged. And we was always kind of moving in that direction. Yeah, we was moving in that direction, and I appreciated him for that.
How do you like working with him overall? Like, you know, what's the experience like? Do you feel any pressure, or do you feel calm?
It's pressure. It's a lot of pressure. If you're working with these guys, it's a ton of pressure. I think initially the pressure was the comparisons, right? So you get compared to other artists he worked with. So if you're talking like whether it's CL or if you're talking about the Nas comparisons, people may compare you to anybody great that he has ever worked with, and you have to sit there and understand that they're not comparing you because of for the wrong reason. They're comparing you for the right reasons. And, you know, you got to remove your ego from it so it's not being bruised in the process. I don't sound like no way, you know, but I think that overall, like, that's how, you know, to answer the question,
Do you think that it helps you grow, being able to put that ego aside and just, you know,
Absolutely. Ego is definitely the enemy of creativity.
Yeah.
By far, on any level, whether you write in a journal, whether you painting, if your ego is in the way, chances are pretty high you can't. The energy is not flowing properly.
How did you guys come up with the name 21 Grams?
When we came up with the title for the 21 Grams, Work This Weight and Soul, it was initially the project was named Work This Weight and Soul, right? And I was watching a documentary on Vice TV, I think that night, something happened. And I saw they was on an experiment in the late 1800s, early 1900s, where they would weigh the bodies of people before they passed and after they passed, right? And the human being body was losing 21 grams of weight consistently. So it was a theory or philosophy saying that the human body loses 21 grams of weight when somebody dies. So the theory was put into place that the soul allegedly may possibly weigh 21 grams, which is the weight of 5 nickels. They also weighed animals and other stuff, and animals weren't consistent with the amount of weight, they grams they would lose when they passed. But most human beings were losing, like, they were saying 18 to 21, but 21 was the consistent number. So that's how I came up with 21 grams worth this weight in soul. So it was kind of like a triple, a double slash triple entendre. And I knew that the title would speak to people and meet people where they at. So if somebody in the street, they're going to automatically think 21 grams is me referring to drug trade. People who know what 21 grams is via, like, the title, like, oh, he's talking about the weight of the soul. And 21 grams worth this weight and soul, people will be like, artistically, this title is speaking to Pete Rock and True Soul is a label. Mm-hmm. And the project being worked this weight and soul.
That's pretty deep.
So it's like the soul is 21 grams worth this, a soul that's worth 21 grams is worth this weight and soul. So,
and I'm glad you clarified that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like you
so
said.
So let me ask you this question, because being a hip hop head for as long as I've been a hip hop head, what made you fall in love with hip hop?
To me, it was just always the drums. The drums and the piano keys were my first, and how they meshed together. You know, as people would say, it started in church. Excuse me, but hip hop didn't have the same parameters as church music, right? So, you know, it wasn't, you can get church music. I mean, church musicians, most of the best musicians we've ever had, most of them came out of the church anyway, right?
Mm-hmm.
Safe to say that, yeah, right? So I think that my love for it came through my sister, Bridget. That introduction to it, she had a lot of tapes and a radio, and she, you know, started getting into, like, you know, her deep into her teenage years, she started to, she just passed everything down to me. She didn't feel the need to listen to it anymore. So she gave me, like, a bunch of cassettes and her radio, and I just would play these cassettes over and over, because I wasn't listening to the radio. I was just playing these records, these tapes she had, whether it was Eric B and Rod Kim. She had a bunch of old tapes, and I would just burn these tapes to death. And that was my introduction. And then I just fell in love with, you know, matching words with, you know, with rhythmic sounds behind it. And it just became like a thing for me. And then that was it. It was off to the races.
So question for you. I'm going to kind of veer it back to music, but then a little bit of just insight. I've been, this last couple weeks, I've been kind of going at it with people on the TL about cancel culture. I hate it. I think it's so ridiculous. And I obviously don't really go in depth anytime I talk about it, just because it's a can of worms I don't have time to open sometimes. So for you, I guess my question for you, Amir, is how do you think cancel culture impacts creatives and artists? And the reason I ask that is because one of my favorite creatives is right now, you know, being, like, totally scrutinized on social media for, you know, a release of something. And every time that it crosses my TL, I speak out about it. And I talk about how people need to just sit this one out. It's not doing anything. So what is your opinion on cancel culture and how that affects the artists?
To me, cancel culture doesn't have a chairman, right? We don't have one person to say who's in charge of a culture. I think it's more of a mindset and what we've allowed it to become. It's kind of like Bitcoin. Like, nobody knows. We gave it value by believing in it. People believe in cancel culture, so it has power. There's no head of it first, right? And it's not to attack your question, but this is just my thought process on it, right? So when I look at it, I would never allow something that doesn't really have power to have dominion over anything that I'm doing in my life, because who really is cancel culture? I think if people really sat down and said, what is this? It's just, you know, when people, no matter what group you're from, whether you can be from whatever your sexual orientation is or whatever your religious belief and whatever, if that was the case, everybody be canceled out, because I'm pretty sure everybody walking the face of the earth has said something that could have got their ass canceled. Nobody wants to have that conversation to be that level of honest, because, you know, once again, this is a different level of self-scrutiny and being still for a year in the house.
But we have seen it impact artists, and we have seen it take hold of people pulling things.
But that
I think we had Jay-Z like apologizing for what he said on
you're talking about those are different playing fields. They're not apologizing to a culture, they're apologizing to corporations.
Right.
It's different.
Right, right. Do you think that affects like your artistry, for example?
I wouldn't give it the power to affect. I would never give it the power to affect what I create.
Dope. Right? Yeah.
Right. But if it affects how it spreads, that's something different. But a creation of it you shouldn't give anything that much power. Right. But once you create this object or this thing and you want to put it in set locations or have corporate entities back it to spread it, that's right. Where the power of this said, you know, cancel culture may even be a conversation if you said something that was inflammatory prior to. So I don't, you know, when I listen to it, I'm like, okay, that's cool, but who is it, like, what, where's the headquarters at,
right?
Like,
yeah,
who do we speak to, who's part of the board of canceling people, who's in charge of canceling, what is the criteria to get canceled? Right. There is no set parameters. It's not a policy in place to say if you say this about anybody in humanity, you're going to get canceled, because this is, you know, is a violation of someone's human rights.
You can't give things power.
You can't give things power. And I think in a perfect world, people don't want to, but when things get taken out of context and then they become inflammatory through people's understanding of it and misunderstanding of it, I should say. Right.
But you just answered.
Yeah. I know, but I'm just saying, like that's how it takes hold. So there isn't really a board or people who are gonna, you know, who do you talk to? Like, you can't go up to a panel and appeal your case or whatever to get yourself reinstated. But it is a very real thing, right? I mean, we've got corporations talking about employees are walking out. We've got, you know, if things happen, and it's a lot of threats and a lot of things like that. So it is very real. I personally think it's absolutely ridiculous. I'm with you. I try not to give it any power, and I never kind of am in that whole thing. But no, I just wanted to know what your opinion was.
I appreciate that question, because a lot of people don't really have the courage to ask it to artists these days, right? Because they feel like they're afraid of what the artist may say, may get his ass canceled anyway. But just saying, for me,
listen, I don't think you can ever get canceled, because you have like disclaimers after everything you say that like totally just unravels the ability to cancel anything. I've heard it several times.
You can't underestimate the people out there, because there's always trolls, there's always haters, there's always somebody looking for attention, and sometimes the only way for them to get attention is
I just don't think that it's people that are looking for attention. Sometimes when you are marginalized and you are being killed by the score, and it is shown that your murder rate is rising from the misunderstanding of your community, I understand their feeling. However, in this particular case, it is misconstrued, because they didn't take what he said in context. However, I don't think that if you're on a public stage and you're calling marginalizing people, that there should be no consequences for your actions, especially because there are transgendered people who are Black. And they are being discriminated not only in their neighborhoods by their people, but also in the LGBTQ arena because there's racism in everything. So I think when we support Black people, we have to remember that we all come in different forms, we come in different shapes. And sometimes, even though what you're saying is truth to you, you have to take into account that somebody else can be hurt by it. When somebody who's rich says that there's no racism, there are people like me who work every day and who have been called the N-word while actually holding someone's intestines in is affected by that. And you have to take that into consideration.
Absolutely. But is that a matter of a ism, or is it a matter of like those three things I said earlier? That's part of the three H's. That's a learned behavior, right? And it doesn't make it right because they learned it. I agree with you. Totally. I agree with you 10,000%. I'm just saying there's multiple moving pieces as to why these things keep perpetuating. If I could keep you, like, we live in a culture where being divided has always been this in-your-face weapon of, not even a weapon of choice. It's a weapon you're just given. You don't have a choice. Mm-hmm. They divide you, right? Mm-hmm. America has always did one thing since its inception, whether it's cowboys or Indians, whether it's slaves versus slave master, whether it's this person group versus this group, whether it's the flower children versus the Vietnam vets, it's always some verses going on. They even got us battling on verses now. It's being sold, a verses is always going on in the news because it keeps this thing going on that I think a lot, not saying you're overlooking it, but as a group, we overlook a lot, that we are always being put in a verse against somebody because we don't have a shared belief. But technically, in most cases, we have more alike than we do not alike. But because that one thing that we don't share together becomes this huge nuclear weapon, right? In most rooms. So I agree with you. It's not something you can glaze over and say it doesn't exist. It absolutely does exist. But canceling someone because of a belief that is opposite of yours is not solving the problem, right? It doesn't. But it does need to be a proper form to how to address it.
Yes,
exactly.
Canceling it is not addressing it.
No.
I mean, I'm not dealing with it. I don't like it. Whatever. You know, we've all been. You said somebody's calling you the N-word. I mean, I was in the military, right? I remember this white kid that called me said something crazy to me, and I started pulling up this book called the ISIS Papers, Keys to the Colors, and I asked him to take a look at it. Next thing you know, I was on extra duty for 45 days. I never said a word, but just take a look at the book. And it was a whole debacle about me saying that. So I've been in multiple situations where, like you said, one group of us is forced to deal with it, other groups are not. But this goes back to what I said earlier about how this level of classism, they put us in subdivisions in these classes, forces us to either be silent or say something. Most people don't have the courage to speak truth to power because they don't have enough finances to do so. Right. I'm pretty sure if you was worth $20 million and that person said that you'd have left his intestines on the table and said, I'm out of here. Maybe, but
probably not.
Yeah. But you know.
I'm a big old softy. Probably not.
Yeah, you know. Yo, I'm just giving an example.
I want to get back into this combo, but since we're talking about verses and all of that, I want to be real controversial. Please don't cancel me. But as far as tomorrow's verses goes, who are you going for, BDP or BDK?
Listen, man.
No.
And this is dead serious. You know, this is the most important question, you know, in this conversation.
Yeah. I'm from a location, bro. It's closer to the Bronx. Let's just keep this a buck, right? But we know what's happening.
I don't want to hear no buts.
Oh, my goodness.
But she's giggling because she already know what it is. I'm not going to say nothing after that. I'm just going to say, you know what I got to hold a flag with. I'm saying this. It's a win for hip-hop. That's a political answer.
Yes. Yes, it is, though. Right? But it is, though.
But it's a political answer, but
it's a true answer.
It's a truth. It's a true answer.
I think there's going to be it can only be one winner.
No, I don't.
You know what, Neville? No. I don't subscribe to that because with RZA and Premier, hip hop won, and Kill got on me for saying that. He was like, "Nah, I'm from Philly. There's always a winner," and I was like, "Listen, bro, like, there is no winner here. Saying, like, I won. Like, I watched that
versus tomorrow night. One of them is gonna admit that they lost.
You know what? I don't think one of them is going to admit it. I think the crowd may do that, right?
Jay-Z still hasn't admitted it.
If you look at, that's cool. But catalog, if you look in the catalog and how people are familiar with them, I'm not going front, bro. KRS stayed Kermit a lot longer. He still put out projects. Big Daddy Kane doesn't. That may be the determining factor, one's catalog being a lot deeper. And stretching across, Kane's last hit stopped at what year?
Yes, and Kara's still relevant because he just dropped something.
Friday? We're not just talking about music. We're talking about his position in the culture. Like he became a voice, an educator. He became, and it wasn't just self appointed. He earned those stripes.
And movements. Kane,
he's definitely been more reserved. He moved to North Carolina. Got fat, no disrespect, and chilled out.
Whoa.
Right? That's not...
did a video, and he actually stated, which I thought was really impressive, he stated that it was okay for people to use his music, some of his old music, for anything without having to, you know, get rights or royalties or nothing. If you want to do a video, anything, and you want to use his music... He was like, you don't need to ask for permission. Go for it. And I thought that was pretty dope.
Yeah. But it also put him financially, that money, that residual income would have helped him during the pandemic.
Yeah.
No shows rocking.
True.
That's facts.
Right? I mean, I get the capacity, but this is equivalent to a dude asking me to do a verse for a pair of sneakers.
I saw that IG live. That was hilarious.
Yeah. I listen, I love the
You're culture, hilarious.
And I love what it stands for, but. You know, I don't think anybody's out here making music for free. Well, no, I retract.
We're doing this for free, Amir.
No, 21 grams was free. Let's just say Amir says that, but 21 grams is not. We don't buy that.
No. You gotta let me package this properly.
Okay.
It was free.
You still haven't packaged who's gonna win, but I'm gonna leave it alone.
You bugging out though, Nevin. It was free to you, bro, but it wasn't free to us.
No, I'm not talking about that. No, I'm not talking about that. And I don't mean to keep cutting, but you did kind of skate around it. So is it BDP or BDK? I'm gonna land my plane.
Listen, man, I'm too slick, man. I'm too sharp to answer the question.
All right.
You heard what I said. Man.
I know.
Yeah.
It's not clear, but I said what I said.
It's a win for the culture. It's a win for the culture. But if you can read between the lines of what I said, then you wouldn't be asking me that no more. Oh, I also said that one's catalog is a lot longer, so that should tell you where it's going.
Boom. That part. Thank you. All right. So it's official.
You got to pay attention. You got to keep up, man.
But it is a win for the culture. I have to be clear that I agree with you when you say that because a lot of people are going to be like, nah, don't give me that win for the culture stuff. I'm totally with there's few times the culture wins. This is going to be like... the second or third time, so.
I've told
Porsha that my militant side, KRS-One won. All the woman in me says Big Daddy Kane won. So there you go. Every part of me is a winner today.
But that's two different audiences there too. You got to think about it. Big Daddy. I mean, his audience is more, he's more visually, aesthetically pleasing to women, right? KRS-One may not have that as his. Yeah, but it doesn't matter. He still, you can't take away what he was, bro. He, the women was on King. You sound, you might be doing some light skin hate right now. King was that guy.
Yeah.
Don't no, Heavy disrespect. D. I don't love disrespect. Heavy D, man. What are you talking about? No hate.
Listen,
no
you
hate.
Can't disrespect what he did, though, bro. He was one of those guys, man. Yeah. I have right. no problem.
He was that dude.
This is what we do as men sometimes. Men have a problem telling another man if he looks nice. It doesn't make you whatever. If a dude get women and he fly, he, yo, bro, you fly, man, they on you.
Yeah. I was just
it don't take none away from me. I'm just telling you. Kane got the women. If the women is in that crowd, it's over for Chris. That's all I could tell you. But if they basing it on skill set, that man is going to be a problem in there.
He's going to be a problem for a few different reasons, and it has nothing to do with the aesthetic.
Absolutely.
Like, yeah, like
absolutely.
KRS,
absolutely.
Like if anyone, KRS is one of, and I think this is like a general consensus, is one of the best performers and one of the best crowd control MCs. Like he absolutely knows how to hold that stage and actually like own it. I am
but
so interested
but
to know.
Don't sleep on Kane.
I'm not sleeping on Kane, but okay, I'll say this. I haven't seen Kane perform per se. I have seen KRS perform.
Don't do that. That's what I'm
saying. Kane was a performer. I don't know if he's still a performer,
but when I can tell you.
When was the last time you saw Kane perform?
Pre-pandemic.
So I saw KRS perform very recently. He has it. That's all I'm going to say is he still
Post
has
pandemic.
It.
Pandemic. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
so,
I don't know.
So
I'm just saying.
Porsha, officially on record, BDP is where you're going. BDP.
I'm always going to stick with the Culture Wins because I just think that it's just going to be such a dope. Such
no,
a dope man. Night.
No,
and
no,
dope performances.
Porsha, nah. 24 hours from nowhere. I feel like it's on record. Which are you? BDP. What about bye?
I don't know. I don't know. I'm not answering that on record.
All right, we'll go
I'm
back to the cancel
front, bro.
Culture.
I'm not going front. He got some joints. He played them joints. It's going to be step into a world.
Yeah.
The bridge is over. My philosophy. Yeah. It's a ton of joints. Sound of the Police. His records that he got is going to sound dope. I'm telling you, Kane's catalog, his catalog is going to stop. It's not going to go past 95, bro.
Boom. That part. All right.
But Kane's a powerhouse. Some of his stuff is resonates well. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah,
I just.
It's not going past.
Porsha's waving right now.
I get it.
I don't know. Why is she waving?
But,
because it's a win for the culture, Nev. You're not getting out of me.
Let's just end all the BS. Everybody in this group, name me 5 Big Daddy Kane records. without looking it up. Name me 5.
Without Googling it?
That's my point. Name me 5.
We're going to edit this.
I can definitely name 5 KRS joints like off
that's
the
all
top.
I gotta
like,
say.
It's just easy.
But,
yeah.
I mean, but it is, it's a win for everybody, but we got to give this facts of facts. Like, he stopped at a certain year, and because of that, if those people from that year back or hip hop purists are not involved in this conversation, he may be up at the fight on social, because social media gonna do the BS. We know that already, right? Yo, so and so one, he smoked them, but no, listen, people who know the difference know that KRS-One's catalog is a little bit stronger and longer. It's a fact.
Yeah, that's true.
Back to cancel
people mad. He had didn't he have mad isn't with channel line? He had mad joints,
of course. Yeah. I just wanted to kind of bring up a little controversy here.
That's
that was all. We could get back to our regular scheduled program. That's just a little, you know.
Kane had a few. He had
yo, Amir ain't letting it go. Amir, we got you, man. We know which side to stand on.
Don't
we know
let
who
it go.
We at.
Don't let it go.
He said light skin. I'm done.
You was hating on him though. You hated a little bit on him.
Yeah, he always hating on him. I don't know.
She said he always hating on
him. I don't know what it is. It's like he was offended that we kept saying,
don't get me in trouble on this podcast. Let's just
that Big Daddy Kane was that dude when we were growing up.
Yes,
and
was.
So it's been some years since he put out anything, but I mean,
no one's gonna forget him.
You can't make a song that had us on the dance floor like Smooth Operator and be like, he play that song and we not just gonna lose our shit. We gonna lose it.
Yep.
Yeah.
I mean, that's true.
I remember like, come on, man, you hurry, hold to cut. Had two cuts on my eyebrows, trying to wild out. You know who he was talking about. Y'all acting like this man didn't really, he's still from Brooklyn. He gotta give him his Brooklyn. Yo, listen, he was keeping a buck. He might have been the first fly month. He definitely came through with the jewelry, the big leather, long trenches, and
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. He did that the right way.
Yeah.
Y'all fronting on him. Yo, Neb, you fronting on him. I'm gonna keep it a buck. I feel some kind of way you fronting on that man.
I love that you said that.
From
the girl who had the two cuts in her eyelashes. And my mom thought I joined the gang and she shaved my eyebrow off. She was like, you can't join the gang.
You were walking around with one bro?
I look like I had finished. No expression.
But
I had
that's
no
the trauma
expression
you went
like
that's why
you're
still with Kane.
Oh, no.
This is like confessions. We gotta get back to the questions though.
So, I have a question for Amir. If whenever we get back to it,
Porsha. Thanks for getting us professional, Porsha. I appreciate it. Let's get professional.
My question is about your Instagram. I actually really like your Instagram because you kind of switch it up. You have. You know, videos that you've put out, you have tracks that are dropping, and then you've got these soul sessions that you do in a car driving, and it's very, very nicely filmed. They're so engaging. Is that something you're working on? Is it going to just always be available on Instagram? Is it going to be something that's coming out on a different format / platform? Give us the goods.
I think for the soul sessions that I was doing, I think I'm on episode 5 or 6.
Yeah.
I got a few more that I haven't put up, but they're just conversational pieces to kind of let, you know, people know how I think and my perspective on a lot of things that I see. My homeboy Giddy Jeff, part of my flash on Instagram, me and him came up with the concept. Of kind of like, because I mean, I'm in my car, we ride around Brooklyn or ride around Manhattan, whatever, turn the camera on, we start asking questions to each other. And next thing you know, he'll be like, oh, this is the moment. It's the magic moment. He always said, oh, this is the magic moment. He takes out the camera. He just knows the question.
Honestly, it is though. Like he definitely knows what magic moments are, because every time I listen to one, I'm like, damn, why am I not in this car? Like, why am I not part of this conversation? Like, they're so dope.
Yeah, so I think the other one, you know, yeah, so we definitely taking it off of the gram, but initially we was just doing, you know, putting it there to get a post check for who and what the response would be. But yeah. I definitely going to probably put them on YouTube and you know, let it just live there. People that don't.
Dope. Very dope.
Yeah. But I'm definitely, you know, thank you for watching it or liking it too, because I was definitely kind of nervous. Well, who would just want to hear me talking trash or.
But it's not trash though. Like you're actually talking about, you know, some of the questions that were even asked on this particular session here. You do go into, I think one of my favorite ones was when you're talking about ageism in hip hop, actually. And that kind of got me talking to other people about that and what their perspective is. And obviously like it varies because as people are, you know, in how I guess immersed in hip hop they are, they would feel it more so than people who aren't, right? And does it happen in different genres? Because we often hear that ageism is a really big thing that kind of goes around in hip hop specifically. And there's often times where it comes up and people are like, this never happens in rock and roll. And someone will come in and be like, but it does. And, you know, so it's kind of like one of those things, like I love the conversation. So yeah, it's very, very insightful.
How do you feel about that? Especially when it comes to the hip hop culture.
I think inside of this culture specifically, it is used to keep and put this on the record too. I don't care who fell away about this. It is honestly used to keep, like I said before, a weapon and tool of divisiveness, right? Because yes. If one generation to the next knew what was done to the generation prior, and especially if you're doing with sports and entertainment, a lot of contractual agreements would not be the same. There would be more ownership. There would be more, like, we the only culture, like I said before on another platform, I was thinking with Mav, I said, we're the only people to go to other people's culture to ask them permission to do our culture, and they tell us how to do it. That is why the ism, that's one of the isms that we allowed to plague it, because we feel like, and then you have older artists, you know, which predominantly are black males, right, in hip hop, right? A lot of these men are traumatized. They have what I told Pete. It's called ITSD, industry traumatic stress disorder, yeah. Right? So they don't know how to deal with each other. They don't even know how to deal with each other on just a basic human level. So when you got money, power, and position involved, it creates more divided reasons to not like each other. But then who suffers, who gains out of us being divided? Once again, the people that are in the office hitting the buttons, oh, we don't want you to do this. You like it like this. The kids are responding to this. Okay, but this culture is going to be 50 years old in 2 years, right? So now you have a child trying to tell you how to do culture that they not a part
nothing
of.
To
they,
do with.
They're not entrenched in it. Mm-hmm. But they're trying. I can't go into a Jesuit rock and roll school if it does exist and tell them how to do that. It's unheard of. Mm-hmm. I can't go into a Sony in Tokyo and tell them, nah, man, we don't like that. Who is we? And why is your input about my culture so important? So that's where the isms that is being told to artists, but also we don't help it either because we help perpetuate it by not bridging the gap and understanding where they at, where the artist doesn't matter, the younger artist, because he got more money when he was 21 than you did. So what? Salute him. You know how long I've watched from the bench or the bleachers and watch artists run past on the court, getting their trophies and their points on the board. And I can speak for me. I didn't hate. I kind of was more motivated. I was like, damn, let me work on my shot. Let me get myself together. Let me, you know, but that's not what's being taught when they get people in the offices and they divide you. They divide you with money and power. They'll tell you this, oh, somebody tried to get more money than you, or they got more likes or more followers, and you shouldn't speak to them because it's not good for your brand. But meanwhile, everything they're telling you goes back to one person who profits. So it stops when certain things are not for sale anymore. Mm-hmm. Your integrity, your value of your moral and ethical compass are not for sale. So it starts there, and I think.
But so often it is for sale. But so often, even like your integrity and your like you can see it. You know what I mean?
I was gonna say, like, you know, for some people, you know, you can say that, but you put the right amount of money in front of them, and you can change their mind.
Absolutely,
you can change somebody's mind with the right amount of money, and that's the way the world works.
Let me tell you something. The money is not going to change the person. It's only going to amplify who they were anyway.
Right.
They can try to fool them. Oh, I'm righteous. Oh, I'm not righteous. Oh, I'm. I've seen hood dudes turn to Carlton from Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. I've seen corporate dudes, thugs, and drug dealers when they got some money. We've seen the shift. They always wanted to be that. It's only going to amplify who you were suppressing or who you really are anyway.
Right? Correct.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I don't disagree with you. I'm just saying, once that statistically less is for sale, then we will have more power over the ageism and all of the other isms that contaminate our cultures the most and not other cultures, because they look up to their rock and roll stars at a 70, 80, and they filling out Madison Square Garden.
Yes.
They're telling you, I don't mess with them. He's over, they over 25 or 30. It ain't it. The kids ain't listening to that. Well, the kids aren't the only person that listen to hip hop. There's a huge demographic that is being underserviced that would love to come out to a concert and not fear getting shot. They want to hear the community or, you know, yes, happening. They will come out to that show if they know this is the vibe, right? So, I mean, I'm not going to drag it, but, you know, that's my take on it.
Nice. So these soul sessions are going to be available on YouTube, hopefully, soon. Back to the soul sessions. They're going to be available on YouTube soon, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, good. Cool.
And I totally agree with you, because I am of a certain age, and I'm going to be 50 in January.
Mm-hmm.
So I have been here since the inception, from watching people. I've watched the struggle. I've watched MCs battling in the lobbies to get an interview. I've watched Supreme Court battles in order to be able to say what you want to say. I've seen the fights, and I've seen the struggle. I've seen artists arrested on stage because of the language that was in their music. I've been to Eminem concerts and watched them protest outside the buildings and try to keep people out from going in. And it disheartens me when I see that people aren't putting value in the history, because there's so much, we have such a rich history in hip hop.
Yeah, we do.
And I think part of the reason it's not as valued by today's artists, well, some of them, is because they bypass the history.
Yeah.
Agreed. Yeah, they get to the bag. I mean, we hear that so much. I'm getting to the bag. It don't matter about nothing else, right?
Right.
So for some people, that is they get into music for the money. They don't get into it for the love. And honestly, if they're feeding their family, they're not out here busting people in the head selling drugs, I applaud it, right? Yeah. But at the same point in time, for the people that want to cultivate the culture, cultivate it and push it forward, they should have an equal voice to do so, you know. But chances of it happening in a perfect world, it will happen. You just got to fight to be heard. So this is not one of those things where people are going to, just take the mic. You know, you got to fight and put in pain. And, you know, interview by interview, stage by stage, and earn your respect, album by album, record by record, verse by verse, line by line. You have to put all of that energy, understand that history, and put it inside of that. And people will gravitate to it. It's inevitable.
Amir, is it true? I hear you you have a bachelor's degree and a master's degree?
Yes, ma'am.
Tell us about that. I'd like to hear about that.
I have a bachelor's in computer science from Fordham, and I have a master's in cybersecurity from the same school.
How was it like doing school? Like, I'm pretty sure you had a lot going on while doing school.
No, it's funny. I was doing mixtapes. It was crazy because I had the first tape I did when I was at Fordham was a mixtape with Don Cannon called The Big Picture. And then I put out a tape called America. And that's when I was over there. I was supposed to go to Interscope with Gene Nelson and G. Robinson and these guys. And I had all these conversations. They're telling me not to sign to anybody. Ended up on MTV when I was in college. But none of it transpired into like monetary gain. It just popularity. But you can't cash in on that if you don't have the right team. So you find yourself in these little positions where, you know, but the most part, I learned a lot about myself, the degrees. I realized in college, 80% of what I needed to learn, I learned outside of the classroom. Mm-hmm. What I learned on campus.
I agree.
And I never looked at, you know, having a degree in computer science and a master's in cybersecurity, that it will one day weaponize me in music. Because now you have so many artists that want to talk technology, but they're not necessarily, I'm going to say some of them are not qualified to speak on certain topics because they don't have the background or the foundation, and watching a YouTube or listening to other people speak about it and you match or copy the verbiage does not make you technology savvy.
Exactly.
So I'm thankful that I made the decision. Well, it was kind of like, you know, I went to school so I can make more music because they paid me to go to school. So when I went, it was kind of like a win-win. And I just took up the computer science part. And then, you know, I became an engineer in the process.
What kind of work were you doing?
Cybersecurity engineer, right? So you learn a lot. And then I was trying to be a regular, not a regular engineer, I would call it, but, you know, software engineer. But those, you know, when you learn it, like stuff like C++, Python, or Bash, and it gets kind of deep in the weeds, it's not a type of role you could just take on and just run. And then, you know, I was nervous because I was trying to hide the music portion of myself and be this other guy. Like, it's like Clark Kent, you at work and you can't tell people. I mean, I've been at a job before, and this dude saw me on WorldStar, and I was eating lunch. He said, "Hey, man, he said, yo, you make music?" I said, "Nah."
Oh, you told him no?
I told him no. I said, "Nah." Because I knew what would come with that. I said, "Nah." He said, "You sure? Because this dude I seen him on WorldStar, bro. He looked just like you. And he had the same name and everything." I said, "I'll tell him you said what's up." And so he started laughing. He said, "Oh, yeah, tell him I said what's up." I said, "Yeah, I'll tell him." And left it at that. So me and the dude, his name was Tim. We became cool after that. But he didn't let the cat out the bag, because now if you understand something, you know.
He was solid. He was like, "Man, that man's solid."
Yeah, you got to run. You run the risk of getting canceled if you say something. You go.
And we circle back.
Yeah.
What was that turning point to deciding to become a full-fledged MC?
It just, like, you know, and like Pete said, man, sometimes, you know, when something is for you, it chooses you. When something is for you, it will find you. Right. So the first deal I had was with Tommy Boy and Warner Brothers. And then when Pete looped back around to get me for True Soul, you know, sometimes you just got to know, you know, when to know. You got to go with the flow. So everything been good ever since.
Nice.
Go ahead, Porsha.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, like you mentioned it at the beginning about Pete, and I think every time I hear you answer questions about Pete Rock and whatnot, I always think to myself, like, Pete Rock's track record, and I've said this before, like, Pete Rock's track record is that he doesn't just link with just anybody. I can bet my life that any MC wants to link with Pete Rock on production or have him produce something, let alone an entire album or whatever. I always want to say in these kind of spaces is that I think people who know Pete Rock or know of the way that he kind of operates, I don't think he would ever attach his name to somebody or vouch for somebody or kind of, yeah, like just link himself with somebody who doesn't fit his brand. At the end of the day, Pete Rock is a brand, and he knows that he, with True Soul now, because it's his label, that's an entire brand. And everything that comes with that becomes the legacy of that label, right? So I don't think that you, like, you're super humble, and you're so humble about, you know, your abilities and the quality of work that you put out. But I just always like to reiterate that there's a reason why, like, you know, you've kind of linked with Pete Rock. He knows quality, he knows excellence, he knows top tier lyricism. CL Smooth is an example. And then we have, like, you know, we have you. So I just want to, again, appreciate that for Pete, for you, for us as fans that get to listen to the, you know, the projects that come out from your guys' diligence and details and, you know, attention to perfection, really. So that's very dope. So I applaud you and I thank you for that.
I sincerely thank you, man. That's a beautiful compliment. I just say that, you know, in dealing with him, it's just been a, It's Pete, you know. He got.
You don't got to tell me. I've coined the Vince McMahon strut. If I ever hear Troy, like everyone knows, like Porsha's walking in that way. So yeah, I hear you. I get it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So the name of the show is Powaful Impak.
Uh-huh.
Who are the three people who made a powerful impact in your life, either professionally or personally?
First, my mother, period. You know, I gotta give it to my mother and my, this is gonna sound crazy and this might go viral, I don't know. And for my father for being absent, my biological pops, right? Mm-hmm. His absence. My Uncle Ross told me this, and I have a father, you know what I'm saying? We call him Vine, right? Those two people, my mother and my father, they instill those, we have intrinsic value, right? But some of the values they instill just can't be. But my Uncle Ross is telling me, you know, when your father and your parents are into shit that is not, you know, good for the kids, you know, he got rumor has it he got deported, but my father hasn't been back to the U.S. in over 20 plus years, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And biological pops, right? I never had a relationship with him. So in his absence, it forced me to sometimes deal with things, even though you do have a father figure and a stepfather who is your father. It's a man in the house and he's teaching you things. There's always that different connection when you know that y'all come from the same gene pool and certain things that you do, the way you look or faces you make come from this person.
Mm-hmm.
I think certain people being present and absent have made an impact. My uncle, like I said, my Uncle Ross was like, I was probably better off that he wasn't around me because of what he was into. And still, what he was into later on in life found me, right? But that triangle of parental presence and absence became the foundation for, you know, people that I met later on. My grandmothers, I have, you know, both of them, they both passed super duper. I mention them a lot in my music. You always people hear me say my grandma, I shout them out as much as I can because there's the love I got for them. And, you know, I can't say, I'm just going to say family 1-3 for me. I can't, to give somebody else that credit would be disrespectful to the fiber of what I come from. Now, let's make family 1, 2, and 3. We could talk about peace. We could talk about artists that influenced me, that I named, that I was fans of, that now I can, you know, embrace and say what's up, call them on the phone and stuff like that. It's too many to name. But the ones that I can't call brother and companion or friend, and they played a major part, man. And three, I would say, and not even to be ghetto, man. I'm going to say the streets. Thank you to the streets, man. Because the streets is a big educator for black men. You know, when you know how to maneuver. Because once you walk out that door, you know, parents, grandmothers, their prayers are with you. But these decisions, you got to make them on you.
Mm-hmm.
And it became my first university before any college degree. So mm-hmm. I learned how, you know, what not to do and what I should be doing in order to propel myself. Definitely made some good. I made good decisions. I made some bad decisions. But thank God that my good decisions outweighed my bad ones. So here we are. So if I had to answer that question, I would package it like that. Hope I made some people proud. That's all.
There you go. And what do you want your legacy to be?
As far as my legacy, and I'm being attached to someone who has a tremendous legacy. When you're attached to Pete Rock's legacy, I don't want to be in a shadow legacy. I want to be a continuation of his legacy. And, you know, he's a continuation of Heavy D's legacy. You know, off. So whoever I can teach, pass on for my time in this position or being in this seat, I'll do my best to be a stand-up person that, you know, is transparent and honest with my people, man, and speak truth to power when needed. And just, you know, pray that the integrity of who I am will never be questioned, or it will be tested, but hopefully it'll never be questioned, you know, because of the bricks I've already laid already. And just, you know, and be a, just, you know, try to be, you know, the best version of myself that I could be, you know, that, and that's for my family, you know. Yeah.
That's amazing.
I like that.
I just want to end with one last question about your mixtape.
Mm-hmm.
As dope as it is, and I couldn't personally do this question because I loved it so much, but what is your favorite track?
Yes. I was waiting for that question.
Today, my favorite track on 21 Good Grams.
Answer. Good answer. Today.
Today, my favorite answer. Today, my favorite track is, mm-hmm. It's okay. The moment we shot a video for it, I need to get, you know, the views are not crazy on the video. I think, actually, I got blocked on YouTube for that song. They said I was, I had a striking or what some type of content on it, because
were your shoes too perfect? What is YouTube's issue here? Were the sneakers too? Were you flexing the sneakers?
Nah, I think it was. I think I had a voice. They, I don't know if they said it was a Farrakhan snippet in the beginning, but it was just like he was just saying.
Oh right.
Yeah. So they blocked it.
They blocked it for a small clip.
So. Mm-hmm. Why is that your favorite song today?
Because of the lyrics in it. I said I'm in the crib watching for a coma. Phone is charging like public enemy. Like that, like the media painted me as a target. If the world is yours, but sometimes I feel like it's running from me. And reading books by Malachi that got me feeling funny. Like those lyrics meant a lot. It's demon time, but I've been moving through the God hour. I fought a lot, breaking atoms while I break dower, while I make dower. In that line, my paragraphs of prophecy painted through the lens of my medulla. On the track, I park ways, but the flow is still Meshula. Size 11 night as a make red. Though, like, these lyrics is ingrained. Like, you know, I'm ready to go with these. I can't even wait to do a show with this. Like that's going to be one of the joints. I can't wait to perform it, right? But I just like it because of just the pedigree of how I approached it. And when Pete heard it, he was like, "Ooh!" He kept sending me man fire emojis when I sent it to him that day. And I just like the record because I like the way it's moving, the instrument, how he did it. I just like everything about that one on 21. I think that's the best representation of the vibe of leading into Dope Boy Soul. Nice. Is that record. It's okay. It's that type of tempo. It's a level of urgency, but also a level of craftsmanship involved in that record. Excuse me.
So we truly appreciate you taking so much of your time to come and talk to us.
Thank you for having me.
It's really special when you just get into a flow and enjoy the conversation. So I really appreciate you taking this time, as much time as you did, because I know everyone's time is precious, and so for you to give that much of your time to us, I truly appreciate it.
No, thank you. Thank y'all for having me, sincerely.
Yeah, for sure. I have one last question.
Okay.
Real quick, before we go, you dropped vinyl first?
Pete, True Soul, did the vinyl. The vinyl thing was because, you know, I liked it. I loved it because I never had a record, a project today on vinyl. It was supposed to be a limited edition of the red vinyl, right? 500 copies of that red signature vinyl of 21 Grams. I would be lying if I told you I know how many were sold, but I don't think any more of the red ones are available. I'm not sure.
Oh my God, that just broke my heart.
hopefully they might be available. You know, somebody.
That,
yeah.
I like that though. That's pretty dope. That, you know, I really like the fact that artists are also including putting out vinyl. You know what I mean? It just, I don't know.
And think about it. I think, you know, for his audience and people that follow him, have always, a lot of those guys are vinyl collectors. They want to put that feeling of pulling that record out and put in the sound of how vinyl, you know, moves. And like, when I got my pieces, I went and bought a record player. I didn't even have one, so I had to go buy one.
Where did you find a record player in 2020?
Best Buy have these ones that fold up like a briefcase and you crack it open. And
you can find them anywhere, actually. They're actually available because of vinyls, yeah.
Yeah, so, and there's been a resurgence in people buying vinyl because for that reason alone, yeah.
Okay. All right, that was all I wanted to ask. I appreciate you, Amir. I really do.
Thank you.
And your outlook on everything. You know, you seem to be a real solid person, and I appreciate all the positive things that you got to say. I really feel like you definitely put out a powerful impact, you know, and I appreciate that.
Thank you. I sincerely appreciate it.
Porsha, you have anything else you want to say before we
go? I'm good. I'm good. I just sent like fire emojis under all of his soul sessions on Instagram. So those are just my comments. He'll see them on Instagram.
We appreciate everybody for tuning in to Powaful Impak podcast with SP, and I really appreciate Porsha and Goddess for coming and doing this interview with me. And a special thank you to Amir. This meant the world to us.
Thank you.
It was one of the most insightful interviews we've had. And I really appreciate you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So everybody subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay connected to the upcoming episodes and follow us on social media. Do you have any social media or projects that you want to tell us about before we go?
Absolutely. We have from True Soul Records, we have Peace Instrumentals 4 coming out. We have Dope Boy Soul in a clip. Both are, you know, TBA as far as date, but we got artwork, so we close. So both albums have... So you know what that means. And I think, you know, everything else is watch out for, you know, follow us on, I'm on IG as AMXXR and on Twitter, 25th Hour Man, number 5, THOURMAN. And I'm pretty much easy, YouTube, same thing, AMXXR on YouTube. So, and Vivo, Amir Vivo, but, and peacebeloved.com, man, always.
Goddess, Porsha, give your shout outs and drop your information as well on what y'all represent.
Just Apartment 5B. Apartment 5B is the dopest podcast, in my opinion. I love this one. I love a lot of them. I listen to them all the time, but I have to shout out my crew, Kill, Eddie, Vern, Wreck. They're amazing, brilliant, awesome people. So, yes, Apartment 5B, hosted by Kill on all streams. Platforms. So that's it.
Well, I'm Goddess Zabby with Love Soap 420, and that's one of my favorite podcasts, of course, because all I like to do is talk about mental health. I like to talk about NFTs, digital art. I'm real into, you know, NFT and digital art. You can definitely find my IG, Goddess Zabby, at Goddess Zabby, Z-A-B-Y. That's it. I'm out.
Okay. Well, peace out, everybody. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming.
Thank you.
Peace out. Powerful Bye, impact. Guys. Boom. Thank you, Amir.
Thank you so much.
All right. Peace.